It'll be a way for you to make some extra money for your real estate. And, you know, like, I just know you and you'd be perfect. So I was like, all right, well, maybe I'll give it a whirl. So I started, you know, a coaching program, and I made an online course, and I had never seen a course before in my life, but I stay on Instagram and I have my YouTube channel and all that. And now it's been amazing. And I met so many people, but I've mostly been able to help people like my friends buy their first rental property and see like a path to financial freedom and a way to get out of just the overwhelming debt. And, you know, everything's just getting so expensive. We can't just rely on our day jobs to carry us forward into retirement. We have to think outside the box nowadays. We have to invest in something, stocks, real estate, whatever it is. And real estate's a guaranteed path. Like, it is. So I've been able to help just hundreds of people personally, and I'm sure thousands.
Now that you've dealt with it, though, how bad was it in the end? It was really bad during it, but like, did like you, like, it obviously didn't bankrupt you. It didn't like go make everything go crazy. Right. It didn't make the investment bad in the end because you held it for a long time, right? Like, how long have you had that house now?
Oh, geez. I think since 2017 or so. Yeah, we had the house. She was in there for 5 or 6 years. 5 years, gotcha. I played that game. I would say that, no, it didn't kill me financially. We had plenty of money. It wasn't our first rental property. But what killed me was the gray hair that I got from constantly talking to her over those 5 years. I talked to her on the phone and through text, and she would have different phone numbers every other week. So I finally had to start talking to her on Messenger because at least that was reliable. But I had so much gray hairs and anxiety, and is she going to pay? Is she not going to pay? Do I have to offer a payment plan? It was stress. It was so stressful most of the entire time she lived there. That is what I never want to go through again. So when people can't pay or they're late, and I have a tenant now who is in some hard times, but I let him know, like, the entire month's rent, I need what I can get the first week, what you can give me. And then if it's not all paid by the 10th, you need to have moved out by the weekend. Like, that's it. And if you don't give me the full rent by the 10th and you don't move out by the weekend, it's eviction time. And he is, right, you know, really amazing. And he does pay. And, you know, I don't know what he's got going on with his girlfriend that lives there, but they keep the place perfectly clean. They follow all the rules. They tell me every time something's broken, that's, you know, major little things, they fix themselves. Their house is kept better than mine. So I really appreciate them and I love them as tenants, and I will help tenants out like that, but only to an extent. When you enable people to pay late and give them too many chances, you're just hurting them. I had another tenant, another mistake tenant from the beginning, and she was in my first rental property, but not my first tenant, and my first tenant there. And it was during the pandemic, and she was having a hard time paying rent, but really she was more lazy. There were plenty of jobs hiring. I live 12 minutes from her. I gave her tons of job applications, and all she wanted was rental assistance. So I'm like, sorry, girl, no. Pay the rent, pay the late fee, borrow from your mom, but I'm not your savior. Go get a job. So finally, she did pay. She paid late, but she did pay. And then finally, as she was caught up and she paid early 1 month, that was when I didn't renew her lease. So when people that are troubled tenants, or you're not quite sure if you want to keep them for the long term, I won't renew their lease and I will let them go month to month just in case, because it's so much easier to say, I'm not renewing your lease, than it is to say you're not paying rent on time, or I don't like how you're treating the property, you have to go. I'd rather leave on a smooth note and just say, you know what, we're not renewing your lease, we have other plans for the property, so here's your 30 or 60 day notice. So I let her go when, gotcha, she was paying on time, and she was like, why are you letting me go? And I just said, wouldn't you rather me let you go when you're up? Like, you're going to get your security deposit back, you know, right, you have money in the bank, like, go find your great place.
Yeah, no, totally makes sense. And then, so let's talk about social media a little bit, because you could have just been, you know, buying these rentals 1 year at a time, keeping it to yourself, just doing whatever, right? But like, I mean, I've seen your social media. You've got all sorts of cool stuff on there. What even inspired you to do that? What's your goal with it? And yeah, why are you doing that?
Well, in about 2019, so we started in 2016, so 17, so 3 years. 3 or 4 years into it, I'm like, well, real estate is really great. Buying rental properties is really great. It's providing us a second income at home. I'm feeling validated as a mom, right? Because I get to raise my 3 kids and I get to help bring in an income, but I don't have to trade my time for hours daily, you know, and go to a job. So I started telling my friends about it in my mom group. Nobody wanted to hear about it. They would listen. They were curious about all the tenant stories, you know, oh, what did she pay? You know, they would ask, but when I'm like, you know, you guys can do this too. Like, not all properties are bad. It was just the one lady, you know, they didn't want to hear it. So I said, you know, I'm going to check out social media. Now, I really hate social media. What I hate about social media is the chest pumping. Like, look how great I am. Look how great I am. Like, I hate that. And not only that, right. I don't really care about seeing my friends' toes on the beach. I don't care about their dogs or their kids really too much. And I don't care about what they had for lunch. So, and that's the kind of things that I would see on Facebook. And I didn't really have Instagram at the time on Facebook. And I'm like, this sucks. Like, I just don't want to hear people promote themselves on social media about how great they are. It made me want to puke. So I said, I'm going to go to check out social media and see if I can help and inspire other people, because my friends don't care. I can inspire other moms and dads or anyone really, the benefits of buying long-term rental properties and how really simple it is. Yeah, you got to get your basics and your foundations right. But once you know what to do, then it's easy street and you can make a second income and it can help support your retirement and it can help with your daily expenses. And it's like having a third person live in our house, giving us rent money, but not taking up any space or eating our food. So that's why I went to social media. I went to Instagram and started posting about how other people can find financial freedom through real estate because my friends didn't want to hear it.
I love it. And it was just because, like, there wasn't really any other reason. You were just like, hey, you know what? This is cool. I'm doing this. I just want to try it out, see what happens. What have been the benefits to you? Because I'm constantly telling people should do social media, right? I probably do some of the pounding on my chest. I'm not going to lie, because that's people part like of the it. Game. Yeah, yeah, people like it, right? But I don't do it too often. Usually I'm trying to just help people more often than not. But tell me, like, how has it helped your business? Has it helped you find deals? Or, like, in what ways has it helped you now?
So since I started social media, my sister started an online business. And her online business teaches regular people how to start their own online business. And before she did this, she was a YouTuber. And so she would tell me, Casey, I'm going to start this new program. I'm going to teach people how to start an online business. You really should too. And I'm like, but I really hate social media. I don't want to do that. And she's like, Casey, you'd be perfect for it. It'll be a way for you to make some extra money for your real estate. And, you know, like, I just know you and you'd be perfect. So I was like, all right, well, maybe I'll give it a whirl. So I started, you know, a coaching program and I made an online course and I had never seen a course before in my life. But I stay on Instagram and I have my YouTube channel and all that. Now it's been amazing. And I met so many people, but I've mostly been able to help people like my friends buy their first rental property and see like a path to financial freedom and a way to get out of just the overwhelming debt. And, you know, everything's just getting so expensive. We can't just rely on our day jobs to carry us forward into retirement. We have to think outside the box nowadays. We have to invest in something, stocks, real estate, whatever it is. And real estate's a guaranteed path. Like, it is. So I've been able to help just hundreds of people personally, and I'm sure thousands just online with my content, understand the foundation principles to not make those same mistakes that I made, especially with my tenant choices, and how they too can find financial freedom through investing in long-term rental properties. So that's what keeps me going now on my Instagram and my YouTube channel, is that I'm just helping people. And the comments that I get and the emails that I get have been just phenomenal.
I love it. I love it so much. And then, yeah, so like, and you've just been a real estate agent other than that, just buying a rental with like real estate agent money. And since then, like, has it been?
I'm not a real estate agent anymore. So I still have my, my broker license for California. And I still keep that active and I use it to get referral fees on houses that I buy. But I don't have my real estate license for Tennessee. I took all the extra classes. I even paid for the test and scheduled a test date. And I didn't show up because I did not want to be a real estate agent again. Now, if I start flipping houses and selling, or hey, if this new whole, you know, National Association of Realtors thing really happens and buyers pay for their own commission, then yes, I will go get my license. But it really wasn't advantageous for me to get my license in Tennessee just to buy houses, because it wasn't really going to save me anything. I could keep my license active from California and get a commission, get, you know, 20-25% off all my deals from my buyer's agent. But I don't have my license, and we still, our income is mostly from my husband. And I have my coaching business income now, which is really great, and I love it. But I wouldn't have been able to even start my online business if I didn't already have rental income supporting me, because it would have been too risky. I would have just needed to go get a real job instead.
Right. Makes sense. So yeah. So what other, like in your journey, like what are your goals? Is it just to buy a house a year, keep doing that, just grow like a rental portfolio of like 30 houses, and then just by that time in like 15 years, just have a ton of houses? Is there a certain point where you stop buying and you just live off of it, and then your husband retires too and you guys just travel the world? Like, what is your ultimate goal with real estate investing?
So initially our goal was to buy 10 houses and have about $100,000 in income so my husband could quit. So we would comp his salary and that'd be it. Well, we met that goal with only 6 properties. So now my next goal, you know, after being in real estate and seeing the potential of all the other strategies and all the things, you know, I get shiny object syndrome too. And oh, is it going to be RV parks next? Is it going to be self-storage next? Is it going to be short-term rentals? Really, like, I love the laziness of long-term rentals. So I think we'll stick to long-term rentals, and we'll probably buy several this year. We were in contract on a short-term rental lake house to also use as our vacation home. So that's why I was going to do the short-term rental. And we just fell out of that last week. So, and that was a huge purchase. So now that we're not going to have money going towards that, I think we're just going to buy several more long-term rentals. And I don't think we'll ever quit. I think that, you know, buying real estate is fun. It's easy. It's our hobby. It's our passion. And I think when my husband ends up not working anymore, which will be fairly soon, he loves what he does. He works with his literal best friends, 2 of them. But when he decides not to anymore, we will travel more and I'll manage remotely still. And we'll just buy more properties. I mean, I teach how to invest out of state. I don't have to invest near me and self-manage. I can easily go buy out of state. I already have the team set up and know the good realtors and PMs and already know the markets. So it's just a matter of me actually going, all right, we're not going to get the lake house. Let's just buy some more real estate.
Awesome. I love it. So talk about it a little bit, because most people are like, oh, that's scary, buying out of state, right? I own some in different states. I own a rental in Georgia I've never even seen before, right? Like, it's possible, right? But what's the difference? Like, what should people know about doing it virtually versus doing it in their own backyard?
The number one thing that people need to get right, and you can fail on other things, but my opinion, the number one thing people need to get right is to really understand your market and your neighborhoods. To be careful what type of property and class of neighborhood that you're buying in, because you may have expectations that will not be met in certain areas. So my opinion is to, let's back up. When I talk to the old white-haired real estate investors, right? What is in their portfolio today? What is in their portfolio are A, rentals, like houses in Nashville, okay? The first thing that investors get rid of are their D-class properties. So why would I want to start out there? D-class properties are to earn your stripes and get your learning experience so you know to never buy those again, in my opinion. So buying there is a recipe for disaster and a recipe to lose all your cash flow. Those houses don't appreciate. Rent goes up very slowly, tons of problems, tons of tenant turnover, and expensive repairs in between tenants. So start with B properties or C properties if possible. And then one day you'll be balls rich enough to just buy Nashville type houses. So if there's anything that the new out-of-state investor needs to know, it's to know their out-of-state market just as good or better than where they live.
Gotcha. I like it. So talk for people who don't know, what's the difference between a B, C, and D neighborhood? What does that actually mean?
So an A-class neighborhood is one where you think luxury neighborhoods, gated community. Mostly the entire neighborhood is made up, 90% or more is owner-occupied properties. These houses do not cash flow. They're very expensive. Then we have D-class properties. And D-class properties are neighborhoods that are mostly tenant-occupied. Hardly anybody owns their own home. And they also, and you can tell by statistics, or you can do Google Drive and get the little yellow man and drive around and you can look at all the deferred maintenance. There's going to be graffiti. There's going to be tarps on the roofs. There's going to be recliners and couches out front. There's going to be people walking around in the daytime and cars parked on the grass, et cetera. Also, these areas have very high crime and poor school ratings, usually one or two. Then we have B class and C class. This is kind of the sweet spot and where you'd like to be. Preferably, I like B class more and I'm not buying in C class anymore. I'm only buying in B class. B class has a lower cash on cash return, but I'm able to raise rents higher. I don't have as much stress. My properties appreciate more. So there's many benefits. So B class properties are areas that are still mostly owner occupied, but there are some tenants there. These are great starter neighborhoods. You have a lot of pride of ownership still in the neighborhoods. And then, so there's a lot of value opportunities in these neighborhoods as well. C-class neighborhoods are where it's more 50-50 renters versus owners. These usually are like the older, depending upon the state and city. I hate to give a year of property age because it varies. But in Memphis, these are going to be the 1950s houses. And they're going to be smaller and they're going to be basic. And they may have carports. And there's going to be some crime, but it's not going to be bad. You're still going to feel safe enough to go there with your family. You just maybe wouldn't live there. You'd live there if like maybe you had to, but it wouldn't be like your first choice. Now, my B-class neighborhoods, I would live there in a heartbeat. I'd be happy to live there. And D, I wouldn't go with a bulletproof vest. So that's kind of, you know, the A, B, C, D quick.
Makes sense. And like D is usually more crime. Like it's like worse neighborhoods, right? Like they're going to be dealing with way worse tenants. Yeah, yeah, it makes sense, right? Like most of mine, I'd say, are in like B or C. Honestly, that's usually where most rentals actually happen. A class, like you're saying, now we're dealing with like, you know, this could be, it's AA, it's like $1 million properties. It's like, why are we even buying here, right? Maybe short-term rental, but yeah, exactly. So we're getting in some questions. I'm going to throw them in here just because I like everyone's small throwing in questions. Hyman was just curious, like, are you buying these 5% down, 20% down? Like, he's curious how much you're putting down on properties.
Sure. So lending rules have changed. And now if you want to go conventional, you're going to be putting 25% down. You can do 20, but if you go conventional, you're going to have more points and a higher rate. So when you look at the numbers, you'd rather put the points towards your down payment than towards lender fees. So we do 25% down now on everything. And 5% would be for owner occupied. If you're going to live there in house hack, you can, but you have to make that your primary residence for 1 year.
Right. Gotcha. And then so how do you get these boots on the ground? How do you get the people that you need, property managers, everybody? How do you find these people in any market, your virtual market, your local market? How do you do that?
Tons of due diligence. You have to know what questions to ask and how to vet them. I have a whole process in my program. It's like several hours long, but the short answer would be, you need to get referrals. You need to, and even referrals isn't even enough, especially with contractors, because I'm sure everyone that's listening has gonna have had a contractor that was referred to them by a friend that did a great job by the friend, but did a crappy job for them. So it takes more than referrals. And especially with property management companies, they make their money in so many different ways. You need to really find out where they make their money. So I tell my students to create a spreadsheet and take a 10-year made-up tenant history scenario, multiple tenants in your property, and pick, you know, this year needed X amount in repairs, and this year X amount in repairs, et cetera. And take all the PMs that you're interested in using and get their rate sheets and find out which one's actually cheaper, okay? Because they'll charge you anywhere from 8 to 10% a month, but that's just like baseline. There are fees for everything. And I have found certain markets, their property management company rates are like out of this world. Like I wouldn't invest there just because how expensive property management is. Like they just take all your cash flow. So Knowing where they're getting their money from will help tell you what their ultimate motive is for your property. I know there's a company near us in Memphis, and everybody knows them. Oh my gosh, there is this guy who came to our Memphis investor group meeting, and he was new, and we're sitting at the networking table. There's about 10 of us, and he's so happy to be there. It's his first day at this first investor group, and he says, I just bought a house, and I'm having it managed by XYZ company. And everyone goes, and sits back in their chairs. And he's like, what did I do? What are they not good? And we all were like, no, they're not good. Sucks for you. And he was like about to cry. But what this company does is they send out repairmen to repair things on the property, right? But they send out their guys. You have to use their guys. And they do a bad job on purpose. And so then you call and you go, oh, I need another repair. Of course you do. And they get sent back out. So they make all their money on extra repairs. So there are companies like that. So asking the right questions, putting together scenarios, and then also checking, you know, how are they putting their best foot forward with their clients? So if you're on Realtor.com or Zillow looking at properties for rent, and you see upside down pictures of properties for rent, pictures out the window, highly pixelated, no lights on in the house with photos taken. It's like, are you going to really hire that company? Now, some people will never check that. And unfortunately, when you hire companies like that, that's the result you're going to get too. You're also going to get upside down pictures from a 1974 camera. You know, so you got to know what questions to ask, how to find the information to make the right decision, because there's even the people on Bigger Pockets, like anybody can put their company and advertise there. So, and I get a lot of students that say, you know, oh, I found Bigger Pockets. Well, that doesn't mean they're golden. Like, you still have to do their research, because anybody can post there. Anybody can pay for advertising and be in their yellow pages, you know. But a lot of due diligence, checking prices and checking communication and checking their, you know, quote, best foot forward. How are they presenting properties for rent? Yeah, I got many more, but.
No, it makes sense. Yeah. So we're starting to close in around the end of the podcast, right? We're starting to get there. And one of the last questions I love asking people is, if you could start over, if you could start from the beginning, Casey, like right when you're starting, what would you do differently knowing everything you knew then? Or sorry, knowing everything you know now, what would you say to your past self right when you were just starting?
I would have talked to me back in 2010 when we made all those 40 offers on California houses. And I would have said, just go for it, because you know what? You know enough. And even if then I didn't have a mentor or even know that that existed, because it didn't exist at the time that I was aware of, I knew enough. And you're never going to know everything. I talk to people that are in analysis paralysis for years and never jump in and buy. And look at all the time that has wasted, all of the equity that they don't have, all the cash flow that they don't have. So if you know enough to get started, and if you're listening to this podcast, there is no excuse. Now you know there are people that can help you. So get someone to help you. Make the right decision so you don't make huge mistakes and you don't set yourself 10 years back. I know people that have bought properties and, you know, they had to foreclose on them during the last market crash of 2008 and they're barely recovering. Don't let that be you. So it's not worth it. Time is short. Life is short. Make your decisions and make them quick. One thing that I've heard is that all the billionaires out there, the one thing they have in common is that they make quick decisions. They don't mull them over for weeks, months, and years. So I'll make a quick decision and just get going with it and get started. You won't know it all.
Right. I got it. I love it. Casey, where can people find you? What's the program that you're talking about? Who's the right person to do the program? Talk to us a little bit about that.
Sure. So you can find me on my website, brickbybrickwealth.com. And my two socials that I'm most active on are Instagram, brickbybrickwealth, as well as YouTube, brickbybrickwealth. And if anyone's interested in learning more about my coaching program, it's called Success with Rental Properties. You can email me, Casey@brickbybrickwealth.com, and I'll send you some info about it, a video to watch, and, you know, see if it's right for you. But it's for new real estate investors looking for a handholding and help through their first experience, their first rental property experience. It's great program, a lot of high touch from me. So you get to see me all the time and get your rental in the next couple months and get it done.
I love it. And then where do you buy? Is it just Memphis or is there any other cities?
Just Memphis for now. Like I said, we were going to buy this out of state lake house, which didn't come to fruition last week. So I don't want too many more houses in Memphis. Politics are a thing. I can see rent control coming down the line. So I don't want to put all my eggs in one basket. We might buy a couple more here, but we'll be utilizing my out-of-state market knowledge to start investing in some other markets. Plus, I won't have to manage, so it'll be a little stress reliever.
I love it. I love it so much. Well, Casey, thank you so much. I appreciate you. Do you have any last words before I end this thing?
I just want to say thanks for having me on. And for everyone that's listening to the, you know, this podcast, fears are a part of everyday life. Everybody has fears all the time. I mean, even Elon Musk has fears, okay? So the best thing you can do is to push yourself through the fear, is to take action and going through it. There's no going around. There's no going over. You go through the fear. Do the action that you're afraid of, and then you won't be afraid of it anymore.
I love it. I love it so much. Casey, thank you so much. Guys, we'll be on. I think we'll be at our regular time, 6 p.m. next week. MST, the week after that, I'm going to be at a wedding. But I appreciate all of you guys so much. Casey, you are amazing. That is Scorch the Fears, episode 116. Let's freaking go.